I'm Joe LaRocca, and in this segment, I'm talking to four experts on the topic of organized retail crime, and we're going to have the great debate. Sitting to my left is Chris DeSantis, Director of Central Investigations and Organized Retail Crime with Macy's, Inc. Down the table is TJ Flynn, the Market Investigations Senior Manager with JCPenney, and Jim Kosseboom, Manager of Investigations and Corporate Security at Ahold USA. And finally, our law enforcement partner, Lieutenant Tariq Shepard with the NYPD's Public Information Office. Gentlemen, thank you all very much for joining us today.
Thank you. Welcome.
So, TJ, let me start with you. According to industry experts, organized retail crime losses exceed $30 billion nationwide. What's the real number?
Thanks for the lead in, Joe. And I know some of this was discussed previously, but I think when you look at that number, are we really capturing everything? Are we talking about just losses happening at the store from boosting? Are we looking at cargo theft? Are we looking at e-commerce, which I heard in the first segment? And when you start to incorporate those different types of criminal acts that are happening at retailers and the losses from that, I think that when you look at that $30 billion number, not only is it believable, but it's probably more.
Even way understated, in fact.
Absolutely could be way understated. I mean, credit card theft, for instance, and the impact that that's having. Now, that's all organized retail crime. So the model that we thought of organized retail crime in the past is switching. It involves a lot more than just boosting out of the stores.
Extremely valuable feedback. And Jim, let me turn to you. The National Retail Security Survey, which was released in June of last year, indicated for the first time in the report's history that external theft actually outpaced internal theft or theft by employees. What do you attribute that to?
I think it's technology, Joe. It's not only the technology that we as retailers have to be able to deter and detect internal theft a lot quicker, but the technology now the thieves have to, whether it's organized retail crime, they don't have to worry about getting rid of the product as difficult. They can go online, they can sell it, they can even sell it before they boost it out of our stores. So it's really technology's double-edged sword for us. I think it's helping us internally reduce our losses, but externally I think it's being used against us as well. And I think with the other part of organized retail crime, what's happening with credit cards right now with EMV, it's losses are ballooning because of technology.
Completely agree. Now, Chris, around the country, there are a number of decriminalization or restorative justice programs that are taking hold. In California, as an example, in 2014, voters passed Proposition 47. Yep. In Texas, the Dallas Police Department told retailers a few years ago, we're just not showing up anymore. Mm-hmm. Fill out a report online and we'll call you when we're ready to talk. How do these decriminalization efforts impact ORC going forward?
Well, Joe, it's a big problem. I got a chance to look at some numbers that came out of California based on Prop 47. And it was clear that the message out there is that there's free access back into our stores. Up to about 50% of the individuals that were released under Prop 47, the inmates that released, were recidivists immediately after. And typically it's for drug crimes or larcenies, but those are gateways to even more violent crimes. So it's a big problem for us. You know, it's hard enough for us to prosecute these type of cases in our retail environments. Now the obstacles are really in our way. We have to now collaborate with retailers to build bigger cases to force district attorneys and judges to really throw the book at individuals. But it's a big problem for us, and it's a big challenge.
And Tariq, from a law enforcement perspective, Lieutenant Shepard, from a law enforcement perspective, thank you. How do these decriminalization efforts impact law enforcement? I know in some cases, law enforcement supports them, and in other cases, they say, no, this is the wrong direction to proceed. I'm sure there's some middle ground and some healthy discussion. What do you think?
Right. Whether or not you agree or disagree with decriminalization is here. And so the biggest message that you want to put out from a law enforcement perspective is you have to plan and be prepared for it. And we have to push some of the same things we've been talking about for years, which is now more than ever, it's important to share information, now more than ever, it's important to think about things like camera placement inside of your stores. So that way, whenever these crimes do occur, that we are collecting eye-level shots of people, making it easier to do investigations. And something else we need to think about is incorporating corrections into all of our partnerships. These members in corrections have been seeing these people for years, every day, inside of the jails. And if they decide to start coming back out and committing these same acts again, well, who better to try and look at these photos and identify these people than corrections? But a lot of times we exclude them from our partnerships.
Interesting. So, Chris, to Tariq's point, there's ways of capturing the data and the information and looking at the analytics. You know, for years now, we've been talking about some sort of high-tech solution or national database to track organized retail crime and other major incidents. Are we any closer?
Well, it's on our to-do list for this year. So there's been some preliminary conversation and dialogue with some of the key retailers out there. It started in 2015. And the goal was to unify existing local orcas because that process is not broken. Let's not change it. Let's not fix it. Let's leverage what already exists from the infrastructure standpoint of the websites and then be able to link those together. And that would give us a more rational solution to what we need to do from a communication perspective. But there are challenges such as funding. And I'm a strong proponent of a pay-to-play aspect. So if you're a retailer who wants to be linked into other retailers across the nation, you may need to pay a nominal fee to be able to subscribe to that. So certainly it would help us bring everybody together, whether you're a department store, specialty, grocery, and be able to impact ORC rings that are affecting us coast to coast, as opposed to in more regional markets. So certainly it's an ongoing project, but I think we're making some progress in 2016.
And Tariq, shifting to you on a similar topic, Chris mentioned the ORCA programs around the country, and here in the New York or the metro region, you were on the ground floor of establishing the ORCA and bringing in other law enforcement partners, and I'll let the retailers comment afterwards. Can you tell us a little bit about where does the metro ORCA stand today? How do retailers get involved?
Well, basically, we went from the New York metro ORCA to now Metro ORCA, and the reason is we expanded all of New Jersey and we're into Pennsylvania now. And so since inception, we are right around 1,500 members. We've really seen a prodigious increase in the amount of people who are interested in what we're doing. And so we expect that number to rise this year because of the expansion. But one of the things we are concerned about is as the membership increases, we ought to make sure that we have rules in place so that way our members are able to input information. You know, we have a lot of law enforcement in these partnerships now, especially in the Metro ORCA, and they want to extract information, they want to take cases. We have prosecutors in there, but you have to make sure that, you know, employees in private industry and the companies that are partners with us are able to put information out.
Right.
And so I think it's one of the examples of collaboration that's really working, and I'm very proud of the core guys that helped us to put this together, and also the law enforcement members who've been supporting us since day one.
That's fantastic. TJ, can you elaborate any more on the Metro ORCA and how things are going from a retail perspective?
It's been an outstanding transition to be one of the areas of the country that didn't have an ORCA group to now where we stand. It's been outstanding. I think one of the most important things, not only is it a forum to put your unsolved crimes up there, organized retail crime incidents, but it connects, a little bit with what Tariq was saying, connects people together. So law enforcement and organized retail crime investigators across this market are now communicating more fluently and sharing the data.
And Jim, last question for you. When we look at sort of the future objectives related to Ahold or maybe overall in the industry, what are the types of things on your radar? What are you looking at now to impact ORC within the company or the broader retail industry?
It's really, it's partnerships with law enforcement, other retailers. The ORCA groups have been great. Our footprint where we operate, the New England, then the New York Metro ORCA, and now soon to come the Mid-Atlantic ORCA. Just an example I had was we put a case out on a Saturday night at 6 p.m. By 6:30, I'd received three calls from two retailers in non-grocery retailers identifying as long as the law enforcement agency. We had that person identified within 45 minutes on a Saturday night.
Wow.
So I think there's just great things to come with these orcas.
Instant success. And
absolutely.
It sounds like all four of you really support the orca programs. If you're not involved already, and you're here in the New York area or in another part of the country where there's an orca program, I think all of us would highly recommend get involved. If you want to make a difference for your company, for the industry, to understand this problem and really make a difference, you have to play. You have to get involved. It might be pay to play, but it's probably worth every single penny if that's the case. Gentlemen, we're going to have to leave it right there. I'm Joe LaRocca. Thank you for joining the Loss Prevention News Network, your number one source of LP news and information. We'll see you soon.